In the tutorial on hemoglobin, we explored hydrophilicity and hydrophobicity. We saw that molecules made primarily of atoms with full or partial charges can typically interact favorably with water because the atoms of water are partially charged. These molecules are called hydrophilic or polar molecules, and they contain ionic and/or polar covalent bonds, which create those charges or partial charges. Molecules made primarily of uncharged atoms typically cannot interact favorably with water, and these molecules are called hydrophobic or nonpolar molecules. They contain mainly nonpolar covalent bonds. Any hydrophilic molecules that neighbor hydrophobic molecules must forego favorable interactions with other hydrophilic molecules. This is what causes the hydrophobic effect. In order to maximize favorable interactions between hydrophilic molecules, hydrophobic molecules clump together, which decreases hydrophobic surface area. This concept applies directly to plasma membranes. Cell membranes, as well as internal membranes, those that enclose organelles, are made of lipids and studded with proteins. The majority of lipids in membranes are phospholipids, which are molecules with both a hydrophilic region and a hydrophobic region. Shown here is phosphatidylcholine, one of the most common phospholipids in plasma membranes. Phospholipids have one or two hydrophobic tails made up of only carbon and hydrogen atoms connected by nonpolar covalent bonds. These are called hydrocarbon tails. The atoms in hydrocarbon tails are uncharged and thus hydrophobic. The hydrophilic head varies between types of phospholipids, but all contain some fully and/or partially charged atoms. Phosphatidylcholine contains both fully charged atoms, shown in blue, and partially charged atoms, shown in green. Each phospholipid is one molecule because the hydrophilic head is covalently bonded to the hydrophobic tails. But because the molecule is rather large, it has two distinct regions with very different chemical properties. Molecules that consist of both hydrophilic and hydrophobic regions are called amphipathic. How does the hydrophobic effect apply to phospholipids? Just as hydrophobic molecules clump together to decrease surface area, so do hydrophobic regions of molecules. But the hydrophilic regions of those same phospholipids are attracted to water because they have charges or partial charges. In order to satisfy these opposing tendencies, phospholipids form a bilayer. The hydrophobic tails associate with each other, while the hydrophilic heads face outward toward water. Only hydrophobic regions are in the middle of this bilayer, so no hydrophilic molecules must forego favorable interactions. However, there are exposed hydrophobic surfaces around the edges of this bilayer sheet. To reduce this hydrophobic surface area, the bilayer forms into a sealed sphere. This is a cross-section of that sphere, whereas this shows what the two halves look like. Looking at the sphere, you would see only hydrophilic heads. If you were inside the sphere, you would still see only hydrophilic heads. These spaces correspond to the watery environment of outside and inside the cell. But the inside of the membrane itself, the inside of those two phospholipid layers that make up the bilayer, consists of only hydrophobic tails. This structure provides a flexible, fluid boundary between the outside and the inside of the cell. The membrane is flexible because it is composed of many different molecules that can move relative to each other. This allows the membrane to distort from spherical into other shapes. How much the molecules move, and thus the fluidity of the membrane, depends on the composition of the cell membrane. Remember that the hydrophobic regions are what drives the phospholipids to form a bilayer in the first place. If the hydrophobic tails are long, maybe 20 to 24 carbons, then each phospholipid has a large hydrophobic surface area, and there's more of a drive to keep those hydrophobic regions tucked away from water. This decreases the fluidity of the membrane. Shorter hydrophobic tails, maybe 14 to 18 carbons, have less hydrophobic surface area and thus less of a tendency to clump together. Shorter hydrophobic regions increase the fluidity of the bilayer. Additionally, the shape of the hydrophobic regions affects the fluidity of the membrane. Most phospholipids have two hydrophobic tails, one that has only single covalent bonds, and one that has at least one double covalent bond, with the rest single covalent. Remember that carbon atoms have four valence electrons to share in covalent bonds. A double covalent bond involves each atom sharing two electrons. So a carbon atom that forms a double covalent bond can be bonded to up to three atoms total, sharing two electrons with another carbon and one electron with each of two other atoms. Compare this to a carbon atom that only forms single covalent bonds. This carbon atom can bond to more hydrogen atoms. A hydrophobic tail that contains a carbon-carbon double bond is bonded to fewer hydrogens than is a hydrophobic tail of the same length that contains only single bonds. Hydrophobic tails that contain double bonds are called unsaturated because they don't have the maximum number of bonds to hydrogen. Hydrophobic tails that contain only single bonds are called saturated. Double bonds in a hydrophobic tail create kinks in the tail because the angle between the atoms is different. These kinked, unsaturated hydrophobic tails don't pack as well with the more regular, saturated hydrophobic tails. As a result, a membrane with unsaturated hydrophobic tails is more fluid than a membrane with only saturated hydrophobic tails. Vegetable oil and margarine are great examples of this. Both are made of hydrophobic tails connected by glycerol, but vegetable oil is liquid, more fluid, at room temperature, while margarine is solid. Would you expect to find more unsaturated hydrocarbons in vegetable oil or in margarine? Vegetable oil, because it's more fluid. In fact, margarine is made by hydrogenating vegetable oil, which turns double bonds into single bonds. To summarize, a membrane composed of phospholipids with short, unsaturated hydrocarbon tails is more fluid than a membrane composed of phospholipids with long, saturated hydrocarbon tails. As you can see, this dynamic lipid bilayer is a great way to segregate the external environment from the internal environment of a cell. Because the membrane interior is hydrophobic, most hydrophilic molecules are unlikely to pass through. Hydrophilic molecules are attracted to other fully or partially charged molecules, not to the uncharged membrane interior. However, there's always at least some small chance that any molecule will pass through the membrane. Two major factors determine how likely it is that a molecule will pass through. Most importantly, how hydrophilic it is, but also how large it is. Hydrophobic molecules, such as oxygen, carbon dioxide, and steroid hormones, are uncharged just like the membrane interior, so they pass through readily. Hydrophilic molecules with only partial charges forego only weak interactions when they leave the watery environment to enter the membrane interior, so if they're small enough, they can pass through readily. Some small hydrophilic, partially charged molecules that can readily pass through cell membranes include water and ethanol. The likelihood that a partially charged molecule passes through a membrane decreases if the molecule is large. For example, glucose, which is 3 times larger than ethanol, is very unlikely to pass through the membrane. Hydrophilic molecules with full charges forego stronger interactions when they leave a watery environment to enter the membrane interior. So ions, such as hydrogen ions, sodium ions, and chloride ions, are extremely unlikely to pass through a membrane, no matter how small they are. This is so unlikely that we often refer to cell membranes as impermeable to ions. But some of these molecules that cannot readily pass through the membrane must occasionally get in and out of the cell, such as nutrients, peptide hormones, and other signaling molecules. This transport is accomplished through proteins that are associated with the cell membrane. Membrane proteins are not only important for transport, they're also involved in a variety of other cell functions. One important type of membrane protein is a transmembrane protein. These proteins span the membrane from one side to the other, and they're often involved in signaling from one side of the cell to the other. Part of the protein is in the extracellular environment, part is in the membrane interior, and part is in the intracellular environment. Because these environments are distinct, the protein must also have three distinct regions in order to interact favorably with its surrounding environment. The extracellular and intracellular environments are watery and hydrophilic, so the parts of the protein that are exposed to these environments must also be hydrophilic in order to interact favorably. The membrane interior is hydrophobic, so the parts of a protein exposed to this environment must also be hydrophobic. In the transmembrane protein tutorial, we'll come back to this to see what protein structures are appropriate for the different properties of each region.